Hare Krishna. So thank you for braving the weather to come here today. And we will discuss on the topic of Krishna's attractiveness, especially as described in the Brahma Samhita, and we'll elaborate on that from other references also. The Brahma Samhita is a very fascinating book. Why is it fascinating? Because it is written by, it is composed by the person who is the creator of the universe. And when he is creating the universe, he has everything in seed form. So, and he's going to create everything. And he has a vision of what is going to come out. But then, generally, whenever we do anything, if you do make a draw painting, if you build a house, we have some vision of what we are doing. And especially if you are doing something in a very systematic, artistic way, then we have to envision it first. So he has a vision, but while he's envisioning this, at that time, he recognizes that although this world is filled with many attractive things, but still, it is not. That attraction doesn't free it from the fact that ultimately this world is a place of distress. And what drives him to create? That is the vision he has got of the ultimate reality and of how the world is meant to take us toward that ultimate reality. That means the point of this world is to point beyond this world. The point of this world. The world exists. What is it? Why does it exist? What is the point of it? The point of the world is to point beyond the world. So, you know, there can be always an argument between the theists and the atheists. The theists can say, you know, there is so much order, there is so much coordination, there is so much intricacy in how the, things work. There must be an organizing principle. And that's a valid argument. But the atheist can point to all the distress, all the suffering which is there in this world. They can say, if all this chaos and distress is there, what kind of organizing principle do you see over here? If at all there's any organizing principle, we can say that that is an evil organizing principle. Because our body is vulnerable to suffering in so many ways. The nature can give us distress in so many ways. So, both sides have valid points. But the underlying presumption over there is that the world is, there are so many good things for our enjoyment in the world. But the opposing argument is there are so many terrible things which obstruct our enjoyment, which take away our enjoyment. But the fundamental assumption there has to be questioned. That assumption is that, okay, is the world meant to be a source of enjoyment? So if we say the world is meant to be a source of enjoyment, yes, there is so much enjoyment, so many attractive things are there. But there are so many destructive things also. So the point of the world is that we could reconcile these two by considering two metaphors. One is the metaphor of a hospital and the other is the metaphor of a jail. In a jail, there is organization, there is discipline, things are organized fairly well, but there is also distress. There is also limitation. There is also deprivation in some ways. Or in a hospital, also things are very well organized. But again, in the hospital there is distress. So basically, the point of the hospital is to get people out of the hospital. Of course, people can get out in two ways. One is they get healthy and they go out. And the other is they go out never to come back anywhere. They go to the crematorium from there. But the point of the hospital is to point outside the hospital. The point of the jail is to point outside the jail. So jail is not meant to be a place where everybody is to live forever, nor is the hospital meant to be a place like that. So if we want to reconcile these two things, that why is there beauty and artistry and happiness in the world? That's because it is all meant to point to some higher beauty, higher artistry, higher happiness beyond the world. But then why is there distress over there? The distress is here so that we don't get captivated and we don't settle down for the pleasure in this world itself. Oh, this is there, I'm happy with this, I don't need anything more. Some people say, in fact, one of my uncles, when I started practicing bhakti maybe 20 years ago, 20, 25 years ago, so I was talking about bhakti with my uncle and he said, I believe in God. He's happy there, I'm happy here. Now, okay, that's nice that you are happy here, but how long are we going to be happy here? The world is a tough place. And almost everybody is working through their own tragedies. No matter how happy and how successful people appear to be, you just scrape a little below their surface. Now, they all, maybe they have lost a loved one, maybe they are battling depression, maybe somebody has betrayed them. Maybe they have some painful inadequacy that they are dealing with. So the world is a tough place. And if we understand this, that the point of the world is to point beyond the world. We don't deny the beauty of the world. We do not deny the pleasure of the world. But what we have to be cautious about is that this beauty, this pleasure is not going to be the source of lasting or ultimate pleasure. And this is the vision that Brahmaji gives us. He has created the world and now he's going to describe in these prayers his attraction, his devotion, his love is not for the world. Normally, whenever we create something, we naturally get attached to it. If we make a painting, we want to keep it carefully. I want to speak of creating a world like this, which is so majestic. But he is seeing the world as valuable because the world offers us a path to go beyond the world to the Supreme Lord. So let's look at, we can go to, let's go to 5.29. And 29, yes. We'll have to. So, what is this that is being pointed beyond this world that is described? So, let's recite this verse as much as possible you can. You'll have to make it much bigger. Can you? So, Chintamani prakara sadmashukalpa vruksha.
Chintamani prakara sadmashukalpa vruksha.
Lakshavriteshu surabhira
bipalayantam.
Lakshmi sahasra shata sambrama sevyamanam. Govindamadi purusham tamaham bhajami.
Govindamadi purusham tamaham bhajami.
So here he is describing this vision of the world beyond this world. And although the world is created very attractive, there is a world beyond this world. And there is a Lord over there. So he describes that world Chintamani. No. Chintamani is a desire fulfilling, is like a jewel which can fulfill all desires, a touchstone. You touch it and then whatever it touches, it transforms into gold. In the material world, unfortunately, there are no Chintamanis. There is only Chinta of money. So, Chintamani, not a touchstone, is that basically the idea is this is a place which is filled with extraordinary opulence. So, Chintamani Prakara Sadmashukalpa Vruksha. The abodes over there. Suppose we go to a house. Sometimes normal houses are made of stones and bricks. Some houses may be made of marble. That's very special. But if some house is made of jewels, it's almost unimaginable. You might have some part of a house decorated with jewels, but to have a house made of jewels itself, that is unimaginable opulence. And not only that, along with that, normally if you think of a beautiful house with, or if you think of a mansion, then there is the human beauty, or the, we say the constructed beauty, but there is also natural beauty. There is maybe a park, there are trees, there is greenery. So he says there is beautiful trees around. But what is the nature of those trees? Kalpa Vruksha. So these are trees which can fulfill all our desires. Normally, whenever we live in the world, we easily understand that the fulfillment of our desires depends not just on us, but on something beyond us. And is there something or someone who can fulfill our desires? Now, when a small infant is there, in some ways, the mother is like the Kalpa Vruksha. Whatever the child wants, the mother provides that. But as we grow up, we start realizing that our desires can't be fulfilled. There's so many desires and so many different kinds of desires. But Kalpa Vruksha, it's the idea over there of talking about Kalpa Vruksha is that nature is so, the tree represents nature over there. And nature is so bountiful that whatever is needed, nature provides. Sarva kama dughamahi. In the first canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, it is said that when Maharaj Yudhishthira was ruling, at that time the earth, Mahi, became the fulfiller of all desires. So we human beings are dependent on nature. And if nature gives abundant prosperity, then we live happily. Nowadays, of course, because we live in cities, we may not realize how much we all ultimately depend on nature. Now, if you ask children today, where does milk come from? It comes from a fridge. we don't recognize that connection which goes beyond. But nature is the source of prosperity. And here, Kalpa Vruksha symbolizes that nature is abundantly giving whatever is required. In the Anand Vrindavan Champu, which is a book written by Kavi Karnapur, it's exquisite poetry. Basically, our acharyas have written many, many books expanding on the 10th canto, where Krishna's pastime and Krishna's abode are beautifully described. So therein it is said that Vrindavan is a place where all seasons in their best features manifest simultaneously. That means, how can they manifest simultaneously? You can't have summer and winter at the same time. But the idea is that whatever is the best that is produced by summer and winter, the best fruits and flowers of summer, the best fruits and flowers of winter, they're both there simultaneously. So nature, to some extent, fulfills our desires also in this world. But it is only for some time and in some quantity. Whereas in that abode, Kalpa Vruksha. So the Kalpa Vruksha, it's a desire fulfilling tree, but the desire fulfilling tree also represents the idea that actually every desire over there that is there is fulfilled. And this is not just one. Sadma Kalpa Vruksha. There are many, many Kalpa Vrukshas like that. Lakshavruteshu. Now, at one level, there is this vision of majestic opulence. See, generally in the world, if we look at beauty or opulence, even in today's world, people understand that there is a certain majesty to, you could say, human opulence. Big skyscrapers and majestic buildings. But there is also a special beauty to natural opulence. That's why people who live in cities, if they are wealthy, they also have some houses in the forest, or they go to outings to somewhere in a natural setting. So Vrindavan is a place which has the majesty of palaces, but along with that, it also has the beauty of the forests. Now, Vrindavan is described over here. Although Krishna is this divine being who has this palaces made of touchstone with desire-fulfilling trees, but what does he do? That he is this God who is going to be described, that actually he is Surabhir Abhipalayantam. He is Surabhir refers to cows. He's taking herding these cows. Abhipalayantam. Palayantam is to take care of. And he is not only taking care of, taking care in every possible way. Abhi means completely. So Bilva Mangal Thakur describes in one of his songs that Krishna, whenever Krishna goes to the forest and when he comes back, at that time he is the last person to come back. So when the Vrajavasis are waiting, they all wait in the evenings. When is Krishna going to come? And when Krishna starts coming, the first thing they say is a dust cloud rising, because all the cows are coming. And when they see the dust cloud, at one level, they stop seeing anything. And when they stop seeing anything, they become joyful, because they know they are going to see something very beautiful now. So then, when the dust cloud rises, the dust cloud starts settling. And then the cows start coming. And then the gopas come. And behind them, at the last, is Krishna and Balaram. And sometimes these cows are restless. And although they are eager to go home, they may wander away. A calf may run here or there. But Krishna is a vigilant cowherd. He makes sure. He knows the name of every single calf. And he calls the calf by names. And he attracts them. Calls them, come back, come back. And his calling is so sweet that the calves can't resist. Somehow the cows just want to hear Krishna call out their name more and more. Then they act as if they're not hearing. And then they hear Krishna call out their name. And then Krishna comes and gently leads the calf back. And so Bilva Mangal Thakur says, Krishna, the cows are known as go. And go also means the senses. Krishna, when the cows wander, you make sure that not even one cow wanders away. You make sure all of them come back. Krishna, my senses are also like go. All of them are wandering, Krishna. Please get them back. Please get them to come back to you, to go with you wherever you are going. So, Abhipalayantam. Krishna is the ultimate protector of the cows, and he is the ultimate protector of our senses. Our senses can take us toward the supreme pleasure, or they can take us toward great trouble. So, this is Krishna is the cowherd taking care of the cows. Abhipalayantam. At Krishna present in our hearts, if we let him take control of our life, he will take control. And take, just as he takes the cows out of all danger, back to the safety of Vrindavans, their sheds, like that Krishna will take us all back, guiding by our senses to his personal abode. And then, Abhipalayantam. So there is this contrast of opulence and simplicity that is described over here. This God, who is the supreme being, who is taking care of cows, you might think he's just an ordinary cowherd boy, but he's not. Lakshmi Sahasrashata Samrama Sevyamanam. He's reminding that this cowherd boy is actually that same person who is served by not just one goddess of fortune, but thousands, thousands and thousands of goddesses of fortune. And they serve Samrama Sevyamanam with great reverence. they serve him normally in, not because he needs them, but rather they need him. All of us, we need the blessings of the goddess of fortune. But the goddess of fortune seeks the blessing of Krishna. And that Lord, who is the Lord of the goddess of fortune, he is now actually serving the cows. This theme of the contrast between somebody very, very wealthy and powerful and doing something very simple. This theme even the gopis talk about in the Gopi Gita. And they say, Trunacharanugam Shriniketanam. Says, Shriniketanam, you are the abode of the goddess of fortune. And yet, what are you doing? You are following those who eat grass. Trunacharanugam. So this is God. It is said in God, all contradictions are reconciled. So in God, there can be the supreme opulence and also the supreme simplicity. He has the most fabulous wealth, but he is doing the simplest of activities, just herding cows. Why? The abode of Vrindavan demonstrates that there is no shortage of opulence in Vrindavan. But at the same time, the real opulence is not things. The real opulence is the reciprocation of love. Krishna is not just sitting in Vrindavan, relaxing. He does what it is required to reciprocate love with his devotees. So there are desire-fulfilling trees in Vrindavan, but the Vrajavasis, whenever they want to do something for Krishna, whenever Radharani wants to cook for Krishna, whenever Yashoda Mai wants to cook for Krishna, they don't go and tell the desire-fulfilling tree. You know, just provide some pakodas and paratas and laddus. I want to feed Krishna. No, although these resources are there, for them this, they want to serve Krishna. So they want to personally put in their effort and cook for Krishna. Similarly, Krishna can sit and just enjoy. But Krishna wants to be engaged in activities that lead to the reciprocation of love. Such an extraordinary vision of God, who is a simple cowherd boy, but at the same time, he is the supreme person. That is, Govindamadipurusham tamaham bhajami. So Brahmaji is praying, and to that, Lord Govinda, who satisfies the senses, satisfies the cows, that Lord, he is Adipurusha. Brahmaji is considered to be the first person, but he is the first person in the universe. The Lord is the original person beyond the universe. And tamaham bhajami, and to that Lord I worship. And to that Lord I offer my obeisances. So let's recite this once again, and then we'll go to the next verse. Chintamani prakara sadmashu kalpa vriksha. Chintamani prakara sadmashu kalpa vriksha. Lakshavriteshu surabhira vipalayantam. Lakshavriteshu surabhira vipalayantam. Lakshmi sahasrashata samrama sevyamanam. Lakshmi sahasrashata samrama sevyamanam. Govindamadipurusham tamaham bhajami. Govindamadipurusham tamaham bhajami. Now, so first he has described the setting and the broad activity. This is the place where God lives and this is what God does. So normally, whenever we look at someone, first we see them from a distance and then the vision comes closer. See, we are looking around, and if we see somebody who interests us, then we focus and look at them more carefully. So like that, he's describing first the abode and the activity. And then now the vision focuses more. And now he describes the personal beauty of Krishna. First is the beauty of the abode and the activity. So let's recite this. Venum kvanantam aravinda dalaya taksham. Venum kvanantam aravinda dalaya taksham.
Barhavatam samasitam buddha sundarangam. Barhavatam samasitam buddha sundarangam. Kandarpa koti kamaniya vishesha shobham. Govindamadi purusham tamaham bhajami.
Govindamadi purusham tamaham bhajami.
So, describe. Normally, when we look at a person, we look at the appearance, but the vision goes to the face first. So, on his face, he sees that he's playing something. He's playing an instrument. Venum kwanantam. He's playing a flute. Aravinda dalayataksham. Looks at his eyes, they are like beautiful lotus petals. Barhavatam sam. So from the vision is moving upward the way. He sees the lips where the flute is there. And the eyes which are like lotus petals. And then above, there is a peacock feather. Barhavatam sam. Asitambuddha sundarangam. His form is very beautiful. And it is like a bluish black monsoon cloud, Asitam Buddha. And how much is the beauty? He gives an indicator over there. Kandarpa koti kamaniya vishesha shobham. That there may be cupids and there can be millions of cupids coming together. Their beauty is superseded by the beauty of Krishna. Vishesha, unique loveliness. That is what he has. And unto that Lord, I offer my worship. So let's look at this once again. Venum kwanantam. Krishna, he in the abode of Vrindavan, he lives just like a cowherd. That means everything that he has basically fits into the setting. So when Krishna and Vrindavan never uses any weapons. Even the demons who come to attack and kill him, Krishna is bala krida kam iva. It is like a child's play. Some demon comes and it's a bakasuri comes and he tries to bite Krishna. Krishna just catches him by the hands, catches his beaks, just pulls him, and he's finished. And Krishna just uses, you know, there are no two demons that Krishna kills in the same way. So it's like a hero who has a special action stunt for every action. So some demon just comes, a big horse comes charging towards him, and Krishna just raises his fist. And the horse is shrieking, his mouth is open, his mouth just goes inside the horse. And Krishna's fist becomes like hot and he can't bear it. And he's finished. Who is that? Keshi. Keshi comes as a horse. So the point I'm making here is everything that Krishna does in Vrindavan fits into the setting of Vrindavan. Now, if somebody comes to a very, say, spiritual place and they come dressed in like very flashy clothes, then it looks very, if somebody comes as if they are going for a party in a 5-star hotel, it's what you could say a rasabhas. It will not gel over there. So Krishna, he will see in this description, there is no description of Sudarshan Chakra. He has the chakra, but that is not the vision that Brahmaji is focusing on. That is not Krishna and Vrindavan. Krishna and Vrindavan does not use any weapons. Although those weapons are there, Krishna, for the Vrajavasis, the weapon by which he doesn't have to kill anybody, just the weapon by which he conquers the hearts of the Vrajavasis is his loveliness, his beauty. Vishesha shobham. And the demons who come over there, that same body which is so sweet and so lovely, that becomes incredibly powerful. Our acharyas describe that there was a demon who came, and when Krishna was just a small baby, he came as a storm and lifted Krishna high up into the sky. Who was that? Dhrunavarta. Now as Dhrunavarta came, at that time we often may, Krishna became heavy and Dhrunavarta crashed down. So basically Dhrunavarta's plan was that he will go high up and he will throw Krishna down. But what Krishna did was, in general, whatever the demons use to try to attack Krishna, Krishna uses that very thing to attack them. So Putana tried to use her breast to poison Krishna. Krishna used that very thing to take away her life. So similarly with every single demon, whatever is their weapon of attack, Krishna turns that weapon against them. Aghasur wanted to swallow Krishna. Krishna went inside him and from inside finished him. So actually he thought, oh, Krishna has come inside me, now he's finished. But when Krishna from inside started becoming big, he realized, hey, what did I do? Better I should have fought with him outside. Now he's inside, what? I can't do anything also. So that which they thought is their greatest strength, Krishna makes that into their greatest vulnerability, their weakness. So why I'm making this point is, Dhrunavarta took Krishna high into the sky and Krishna increased his weight, and so much the very plan that he had, that he will throw Krishna down, he was thrown down. But Vishwanatha Chakra Thakur explains that actually Krishna, the Dhrunavarta did not die because he crashed on the ground. Actually what happened, Krishna said, whatever you do to me, I am going to do to you. So when he wanted to catch Krishna and take him, he held tightly so that Krishna will be taken high up into the sky. So Krishna said, you are holding me tightly, I will hold you tightly. And Krishna, as he was going high into the sky, Krishna says, small baby. So he put his hands around Dhrunavarta's neck. And Dhrunavarta thought, oh, this baby must have got frightened. So he's holding on to me very tightly. But Krishna had his own plan. And Krishna held on to this Dhrunavarta so tightly that he just choked him by his tiny hands. And his eyes started becoming big and he couldn't breathe. And actually what crashed down was Dhrunavarta's dead body. So Dhrunavarta did not die because he crashed down. It was rather, it was he died and then he crashed down. So Krishna is so powerful that he can, his whole tender body can become incredibly powerful. That same verse which I quoted, Trunacharanugam Shriniketanam. The gopis are saying, when Krishna goes into the forest, they say that, Krishna, your feet are so tender that if a twig or a thorn pierces it, we feel as if our heart is being ripped apart. That tender Krishna's feet are. But what those tender feet, what does Krishna do? Fani fanarpitam te padambujam. Fani fanarpitam. Who is funny? Who's? Kaliya. So if it's fana, they are saying, Krishna, you offered your lotus feet to Kaliya. But Kaliya did not understand what he was getting. And those gentle lotus feet became like thunderbolts for him. So even when Krishna has to act, you could say in a sense, out of script. A small child, how can a child fight against a demon who has raised him high into the sky? When Krishna has to act out of script, the demon's script was that I will take him high up and smash him down. Even when Krishna has to act out of script in Vrindavan, he does not need anything that is outside the setting of Vrindavan. In fact, when Aghasur is killed, see, Aghasur's body becomes like a plaything for the Vrajvasis. So everything is integrated by Krishna into his beautiful pastimes. So similarly, when Krishna, he has music over there. But he doesn't have any sophisticated instruments. He does not need, in the spiritual world, he does not need a harmonium or a piano or certainly not a music synthesizer. He has a simple flute. A flute can be very easily made, simply a bamboo stick he takes and make some holes in it and just use that. So he makes the most incredibly attractive music the simplest of objects. Venum kvanantam. And Krishna plays the flute. It is for his devotees, whether it is his cowherd boyfriends or the cowherd gopis or the cows. Now it is as if Krishna's love is coming out of his heart. And that sound, the flute, is almost like through that sound, the invisible ropes of love are going and they're falling around the hearts of his devotees. And they're pulled from wherever they are to come towards him. Swarita venuna shushtu chumbitam. The gopis say, Krishna, this flute, how has it become so fortunate that it gets the nectar of your lips? You kiss it so often. And they say, what happens? When they come running into the Raslila to Krishna. So they say that Tava Udgita Mohitaha. He says, we were deluded by the loud music, loud sweet, loud song of the flute. Now normally if somebody does kirtan, and then he said, Prabhu, the kirtan was so loud. He said, is that a compliment? It's like suppose somebody offers us prasad and then ask, how was the prasad? He says, it was edible. What? So sometimes you can, it's like you damn by faint praise. So it's like a faint praise is a strong criticism. So now is to say that the flute music is loud. Now is that praise or is it criticism? The gopis, what they're saying is, Krishna's flute song is very sweet. But for them, when Krishna calls by playing the flute, they just can't hear anything else. Pati sutanvaya bhratru bandhavan ati vilangyate antyachyutagataha. That our family members were telling him, don't go, it's night, where are you going? You're not supposed to go, you have work to do here. They just couldn't hear anything that anyone else was saying. Just ran. Because for them, that sound was so loud. Just like a mother has a small baby, and the mother might be working in the kitchen, the baby is in the bedroom. But if the baby makes a small movement, even the baby is not crying loudly, the mother's ears are so attuned. Oh, the baby has woken up, immediately she will go there. So when there is love, even the smallest sound is very loudly heard. So this is Krishna plays the flute and he conquers the hearts of everyone. Venum kvanantam aravinda dalaya taksham. His eyes are like beautiful lotus petals. The idea over there is that generally if we want to know how genuine a person is. Now, many people can very easily plaster a smile on their face. But if you want to know what is the emotion, look at their eyes. How much is the warmth going into their eyes? Sometimes people have what they call a secretary smile. So they can smile out of dutiful politeness. But in the eyes, there is no really warmth or affection. In general, we can control our facial expressions quite well. But our eyes, we can't control that much. The eyes are they reflexively reflect what is going on in our hearts. And those who are very advanced and saintly, you'll see that their eyes are not very restless. Their eyes are steady. Because they're thinking wherever, of course, if it's required, they will be alert. But their eyes are fixed. Okay, this is where I have to serve Krishna, let me focus on this. Then this is where I have to serve Krishna, I'll focus on this. So Krishna's eyes, when it is said they're like lotus petals, it conveys, firstly, of course, the beauty. Lotus is extremely beautiful. And similarly, the eyes are very beautiful, beautifully shaped, beautifully formed. But the lotus also conveys transcendence. The lotus exists in a, may exist in dirty water, but lotus beauty is not contaminated by the dirty water. So Krishna's glance is always pure and is always purifying. Now our glances, they are often, because of the desires over there, they are not so pure. But Barahavata, so he said that it is Aravindadalayataksham. And then Barahavatamsam, he wears a peacock feather. Again, as I said, everything about Vrindavan is pure and natural. So Vrindavan is the original eco-friendly place. Now, all the decorations and everything is completely eco-friendly. So what is over here? He is wearing a peacock feather. Now what happens over here is that there are many different stories, but the Brajavasis tell one story that once Krishna was at his home and Radharani was at her home. Krishna was in Gokul and Radharani was in, Krishna was in Vrindavan, Radharani was in Barsana. And then Krishna was playing with his friends and suddenly he had a desire to be with Radharani. He said, "What?" Krishna said, "How can I just leave my friends and go away? And if I go away like this, first of all they will ask me, and if they come to know they will tease me." So he says, "What do I do?" So at that time, as they were playing, they were actually in the forest near Vrindavan. They're playing all around there. So there was a peacock over there. And then Krishna and the Gopas, they would play with the animals. Sometimes they would chase one of the birds, or they would try to imitate the bird sounds. They would make, like monkeys, they would imitate their actions. So there was one peacock. And Krishna saw that peacock, and Krishna started running after the peacock. And that peacock kept running. And Krishna kept running. Normally the birds would run, and animals would run, they would run for some time, and they would go away, and they would stop. The cowherd boys would stop running. But this peacock just kept running straight. And Krishna kept running behind this peacock. And finally, the peacock ran all the way to Barsana. And that is where Radharani was there. And finally, as this peacock reached Barsana, and Radharani was peering out of the window of her house. And as this peacock reached Barsana, a beautiful feather fell off from his body. And Krishna said, "Oh peacock, you have done such a special service for me. You have united me with my beloved Radharani. Therefore, as a memento to your love," he took the peacock feather and he put it on his forehead. So, Barahavatamsam. And then, Asitambuda Sundarangam. He is incredible. His complexion is extraordinary. It is bluish black. When Srila Prabhupada went to America, at that time, there was a lot of racial tension going on in America. The civil rights movement was there, and still a certain amount of racism was there. So one of Prabhupada's disciples was a professor in a college. And he was in a college, and what happened? He started speaking about Krishna over there. So he was in Ohio State University. His professor is a high degree professor, Howard Wheeler he was. So then his college authorities called him and they said, "Hey, we heard in your English classes you're talking about God." So he said, "I didn't know there was any rule against talking about God." Because they were discussing something about Shakespeare and there was some reference to God. In that context, he had said, "Yes, that's okay, but you're talking about a strange conception of God." He said, "Okay, what is your conception of God?" He said, "No, I have no conception of God." So if you have no conception of God, then how can you say my conception is strange? No. Oh, but you are talking about a God who is a cowboy. He says, "No, he's not a cowboy, he's a cowherd boy."
You know, there are the Western movies with cowboys who ride on, you know, horses and shoot with guns. He's not a cowboy, he's a cowherd boy.
He says, and you're talking about a god who is black? He said, now at that time there's racial tension was going on, so there's whites and blacks. He says, you're talking about a god who is black? He says, no, he's blue. Blue! So, Asitambuddha Sundarangam. We also have temples in Africa. So, now some parts of Africa are quite unstable. Often the law and order is not very strong, and there are some thieves and dacoits who come and steal things over there. So, once, now our devotees, Prabhupada kept the decorations beautiful but not very expensive. So, but anyway, so once some dacoits came into the temple and they said, what is there valuable? They want to steal. And then they saw the altar. And they looked at the altar and they were about to charge. They thought maybe there is a jewels or whatever is valuable. And then their head, he says, stop. And he looked at the altar carefully. He said, oh, he says, there's a white woman and black man. Let's keep them.
So, Krishna has his own ways of attracting different people.
So, Krishna is neither blue nor black. He is transcendental. But we can get some indication of how he is. So, Asitambuddha, the example that is given is of a newly formed monsoon cloud. Sundarangam is extremely beautiful. Rupa Goswami has written a number of books describing Krishna's pastime. So in Lalita Madhava and Vidagdha Madhava, this describes Krishna's union with his devotees in the Madhuri Ras and his separation from them. So there he describes how there's a great devotee of Krishna who writes very beautiful poetry to glorify Krishna. And then finally he has darshan of Krishna. And when he has darshan, at that time, he says, Krishna, I wrote such choice poetry to glorify you. But now, when I'm actually encountering your beauty, then I realize that your beauty is so infinite, so beyond verbal description, that my words glorifying you and your beauty, they are like, if there is a person who is the emperor of the world and you glorify him, oh, you are the landlord of this village, how powerful you are. So he says that glorification is so inadequate that it becomes like criticism. So when our glorification or whatever is spoken, it's only indicative. It is not descriptive. There's a great devotee of Ram, and he's describing the beauty of Ram, and he writes poetry. He says that Ram's eyes are as beautiful as Ram's eyes. He says, there is no metaphor that can describe that beauty. But still, as an indication, certain points are told. So here it is said, Kandarpa koti kamaniya vishesha shobham, that Cupid is considered to be very attractive. In fact, Cupid, the beauty of this world is such that actually the beauty captivates us. But it is not that everyone's beauty captivates everyone. So even if somebody is beautiful, not everybody necessarily, everybody is attracted to some beauty, but sometimes there's an irresistible attraction to some beauty. So why does that happen? That is not just the beauty that they possess. But when a particular attraction is developing between, say, two people, at that time, Cupid, you could say, shoots arrows from the attractive person's heart. And that's how that, for that person, the person whom they're attracted to appears to be like supremely beautiful. That's why it is said beauty lies where? In the eyes of the beholder. Of course, you can say some people are more beautiful than others. So beauty, of course, is an objective reality. But the magnitude of the beauty and the magnitude of the captivation caused by that beauty, that is not the same for everyone. And why is that different? Because that's Cupid acting. Cupid is Kamadev. He's Madan. Now, Krishna says that this attraction also has a purpose. Prajanascha asmi kandarpaha. So he says Kandarpa is the god of love. And Prajanas, he says, among all causes of procreation, I am Kandarpa. So when people are attracted to each other, and when there is genuine affection, and within that affection, then there is procreation. Then through that, the children that are born, that's Krishna says, I am that. So this attraction is not always bad. But when that attraction is in adharmic directions, that's where it goes wrong. But the point is that when somebody finds somebody very extremely attractive, that is actually Cupid acting. Others cannot understand, why are you so captivated? What is there in this? But it is Cupid who has shot the arrow. So we could say there is objectively things are more beautiful or less beautiful, but there is objective beauty and there is subjective perception of the beauty. Subjective perception of the beauty means that somebody might feel this person is so beautiful. So that subjective perception of the beauty is what makes us act. And that is caused by Cupid. But he said that even if thousands or millions of Cupids come together and all of them shoot their arrows, then the amount of captivation would be extraordinary. But still, that captivation is not comparable to the captivation that Krishna can exert when his beauty is revealed to us. So Krishna's beauty is far, far greater than not just the objective beauty present in the world, but also greater than the subjective perception of the beauty that people may have. Of course, to perceive Krishna's beauty requires purification. Why is that? Because what we find attractive depends not just on how attractive it is, but also depends on what kind of desires we have. It's like a bottle of alcohol, well, it's a bottle. It may not look particularly attractive. But for somebody who has that desire, it is supremely attractive for them. Isn't it? They're ready to give up everything for that. Sarva dharman parityajya
maya mekam sharanam raja.
So, at one level, what we need to do is, with whatever little desire we have, we try to direct our consciousness, our heart toward Krishna. And as we keep directing our heart toward Krishna, so right now what we do is, we practice conscientious devotion. Our heart, our eyes, our consciousness goes in various directions, we bring it back toward Krishna. That's conscientious devotion we need to practice. But as we keep practicing conscientious devotion, gradually this devotion will blossom and it will become spontaneous devotion. That's when we will become more and more attracted to Krishna. But at least we can have that understanding. Oh, if the beauty of this world is so attractive that people are ready to give up everything when they get captivated by the beauty. And that beauty is just a spark of Krishna's beauty. So one Kandarpa is creating this captivation. One Cupid is creating this irresistible force of attraction. Then if somebody has the potency of millions of Cupids, how much attraction can be there in that? And how much beauty must be there to have that captivation? So it is that captivation that the great devotees have. You know, that is what made Rupa Goswami, Jiva Goswami, Rupa Goswami, Sanatana Goswami, Raghunatha Goswami, they had the best pleasures of the world. But it is because their heart was conquered by Krishna. Just gave up everything, nothing. Yad rasamritriptasya na anyatra syadrati kochit. This what applies to Krishna also applies to the Bhagavatam. if we can relish the Bhagavata, if we can develop a taste for the Bhagavata, once we get that taste, then no other taste will attract us. Or even if you're attracted to something else, we will see that actually this is also meant to direct me toward Krishna. It's not that we reject necessarily all tastes, but we see that no other taste is meaningful unless it is directing me toward the supreme taste of Krishna. So this is the vision of Krishna's loveliness that is given to us by Brahmaji in the Brahma Samhita. I was planning to take one more verse, but I think we are running out of time. The next verse talks about further about Krishna's personal beauty. Maybe we'll continue this some other time. Okay. So I'll summarize. I spoke today about how the point of the world is to point beyond the world. Brahmaji has created this beautiful world, but he is not glorifying his creation. Somebody writes a book or makes a painting, they'll praise that. But he is praising the Lord who is meant to be attained to this creation. The world has beauty, but the world also has misery. So it's like a hospital or a jail. The point of both of these is to get us out of there. So how do we get out of there? By understanding what is so attractive beyond this world. And that vision is given by Brahmaji over here in this prayer. So we discussed two of the verses. The first verse I talked about how it is a abode of majestic opulence. There are touchstones and desire fulfilling trees. And the desire fulfilling trees also indicate the abundant bountiful gifts of nature. But despite all this, Krishna is engaged in those activities which comprise the reciprocation of love. He is taking care of the cows. And similarly, can pray that he takes care of our senses, which are also by the same name, cows. Go. And then that Krishna who is in such simplicity, we shouldn't think that he's a simple person. He's served by thousands and thousands of goddesses of fortune with great reverence. So in God, all contradictions are resolved. There is majestic opulence and there is complete simplicity. So, I talk about how Vrindavan, all the best products of all the seasons are simultaneously there. Whatever Krishna desires, Vrindavan provides that. And then we talked about, after describing the abode and the activity of the Lord of that abode, then the vision focuses on the person who is there in that abode. And that is, his beauty is described starting from the face. He's playing Venu. So we talked about how Krishna in Vrindavan fits into the setting of Vrindavan. Now he doesn't use weapons to fight against enemies. Just with unique action stunts where his own gentle body becomes formidable, he overcomes the demons. And if he wants something, he fashions it simply with the bamboo from the forest. He makes a flute. But when through that flute sound which comes out, it's his love coming out. And it's like ropes are cast on those whom he is calling and just get pulled. And that's why the gopis feel that this flute sound is loud. Not that it is jarring, but it is so captivating that they can't hear anything else. Aravinda dalayataksham. Talked about how the eyes reveal the heart much more than the lips. And Krishna's eyes are beautifully shaped, but they also glimpses into the beauty of his heart. He loves everyone. Then I talked about Barhavatamsam. How peacock feathers are very beautiful, and because the peacock united Krishna with Radha, so that's how Krishna is putting that peacock feather. And Asitambuddha, his beauty is beyond verbal description, but in its own way, Krishna can attract all of us towards him. And then lastly, I talked about how whatever we are attracted to in this world, Kandarpa Koti, there is objective beauty, there is subjective perception of beauty. Krishna's beauty is the supreme in both. And by practicing spontaneous devotion, gradually we can come to conscientious devotion where we will become completely absorbed in Krishna. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Any questions or comments? The answer is very simple. That is the only one I know.
There is the issue of Krishna Kathamrita Bindu, in which they had said that there are many stories. We will tell one story. So this is the only story I know.
Yes, please. Yes. If Krishna is so attractive, why are so many people not attracted to him? Why so many people, you know? Why are we ourselves not so attracted to him also, isn't it?
Yeah.
Krishna does not use his attractiveness to overrule our free will. God has given all of us free will. And free will is of no meaning unless there is the capacity to exercise the free will. It's like if you tell someone, you are completely free to express your mind as long as you agree with me.
It's like whatever freedom you are giving with one hand, you are taking it all away with the other hand.
So, that's pseudo freedom. So similarly, if we are given free will, that means that we should also have the facility to exercise that free will. And if Krishna is the only attractive thing in the world, and everything else is utterly unattractive, then where is the free will over there? Isn't it? It's like if somebody tells you, okay, we have 15 items in the menu, okay, but why, we have 15 different, in a hotel you are saying, 15 delicacies, 15 different items you can serve you. Now, it's only one of them is like fresh and rich and sweet and everything else is rotten and stinking and terrible. No, that choice is no choice at all, isn't it? So, it is in the Vishnu Sahasranam, it is said that Kamaha, Kamada, Kamyo, three names are given to glorify Vishnu, and it says Kamaha, Kamada, Kamyo, that Kamaha is the one who is the destroyer of desires, he is the one who is the fulfiller of desires, and he is the supreme desirable. Now Kamaha, it can be presented in two ways, it's Kamaha or Kamaha. So Kamaha is destroyer of desires, Kamaha is simply his desire itself. So what that means is that whatever desires we get those desires because something is desirable. Now where does that desirableness of that object come from? It also comes from Krishna. So, this is a calm. Now, when there is something which is desirable and we desire it, so you, O Lord, are the desirability of all desirable objects. And you are Kamaha and you are Kamada. That means it is you who fulfill that desire also. Sometimes we desire something, but we may not get it. We may strive for it, but still, unless there is something beyond us that works also for us, we won't get it. And then he says, you are Kamaha, Kamada, Kamya. That means you are the supremely desirable object. So, because we all have desires and various kinds of desires, free will means we can choose to enjoy through things other than Krishna. And there has to be a facility for that. And that facility means that other things also have to look attractive. Otherwise, what is the meaning?
A free will.
If there is nothing to execute, to exercise the free will, then it's if somebody traps somebody, if somebody is, you know, in the middle of a big desert, and they tell you, you know, you can go wherever you want, you are completely free. But wherever you go, you starve and die of what? Hunger and thirst. Well, you are free, but you are not free, because there is practically no option. So like that, Krishna doesn't use his attractiveness to override our free will. That's why he imbues other things also with a fraction of his attractiveness. Now, depending on the level of our desires, we will find those particular objects as attractive. And to the extent we start desiring Krishna, and we start desiring Krishna more and more, to that extent, yetha mam prapadyante tam sathaiva bhajamyaham. Krishna says, as we surrender to him, he rewards us. And what is his reward? He is himself the greatest reward. Krishna is Krishna's greatest gift. So when we approach him with devotion, Krishna can fulfill our various desires. But the greatest blessing Krishna can give us is he reveals his attractiveness to us. And even a glimpse of his attractiveness can captivate us. So as we keep practicing bhakti, our practice of bhakti is basically meant to show Krishna that, Krishna, I want to love you. I want to devote myself to you. So to the extent we keep doing that, to that extent we will move forward and Krishna's beauty will be revealed to us. So it's a gradual process. Like in the mornings, say if we are going for a japa walk at dawn, then it's dark, it's twilight, and we keep chanting and we keep walking, and suddenly, hey, it's sunlight, it's day. So it is not that the day is the sun is constantly rising, but at one particular moment we realize, oh, the sun has risen. So like that, every single day that we are practicing Krishna bhakti, the sun of Krishna is rising in our heart. At one particular time, we'll realize, hey, I have no attraction to other things. This is Krishna is what I'm attracted to. So it will happen gradually as we keep practicing bhakti. Nitya siddha Krishna prem sadhya kabunai shravanadi shuddha chitte karaye udai. That love for Krishna prem, that will arise in our heart if we just keep hearing and practicing, hearing and chanting and continuing the practice of bhakti. Shravanadi shuddha chitta karaye udai. It will rise in our heart like a sun. Okay. Thank you. So we'll stop here. Shri Krishna Bhagavan ki. Srila Prabhupada ki. Gaura Bhakta Vrinda ki. Tai Gaur Premanande. Yeah.